Hello and welcome to PM Personality Profile. My name is Nanan Sakwal the Fourth, and it's one of the very unusual interviews I'm going to do because I've been digging around. Maybe it tells you what the man does, but nobody seems to know much, apart from the fact that as when it comes to security, he's a thespian and an authority. That much we have all come to accept. Anytime there's an issue with security in the nation, internationally, we call on Dr. Kwesi Eni. However, nobody knows how he became Dr. Kwesi Eni, other than that we know that, look, he's Dr. Kwesi Eni. Obviously, director for research, director for the Kofi Annan Peacekeeping Faculty for academia. But what made him the security captain? What gives him that knowledge that we all tap into morning in and morning out? And well, with the happenings now, I'm sure he hasn't got any peace of mind. And so I thought, you know, let me go in and talk to him. First, I thought he was going to say no. I was excited when he said yes. And I've spoken to quite a few of you guys out there who are always, you know, who've got all these big ears up thinking, I really want to know how he became a security expert. Folks, I'm here to talk to Dr. Kwesi Eni. In fact, he's our darling security expert. Come to our darling security expert. So you have to bear with me when I'm asking the questions because I don't really know much about him. Other than that, I respect him. I think he's done a very good job. We all know he's done a good job. And that's just the premises with which I'm here, which is very unusual because as a presenter, I should have done a few digging and come with some apple. I have no apple whatsoever. I'm coming into this examination empty-handed. Stay tuned. When I come back, you and I are going to find out how it is that Dr. Kwesi Eni becomes such an expert in his field. Don't go. Well, thank you very much for staying. And this is the favorite part. Dr. Kwesi Eni, thank you because I was quite pleasantly surprised when you obliged to the interview. I thought you were going to say, look, Nana, not at this time. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you too for extending the invitation.
Good. Doc, if I'm going to take you back, am I taking you back to Omina or Teshi? You know, where were you born? Where did you grow up?
No, I think you take me all the way back to Esamankese, where I was born.
Okay.
Where I had the first couple of years of my childhood. Mm-hmm. But also to Akimo Dam,
okay,
where my father was one of the pioneers of establishing the Odan Secondary School. Drove on the same bus with the late vice president to Odan Methodist School. But the fascinating thing is that I think Dad took me to my first political campaign when I was 6 or 7.
Who was then, which campaign season was
this? Well, I mean, my family history, both my father and my mother, have been from the UGCC tradition.
Okay.
And I think when we had our earlier conversation, I told you I was going for a funeral last Saturday, and only went to realize that my grand uncle was the majority leader under Dr. Buzia. You know, so I come from a long history of royalty and of political activists. Dad himself, apart from being a school teacher, was also a trade unionist.
Okay.
You know, so I'm actually, as I grow old, I'm getting to my pension age, you know, I'm going back to say, and I think the question that you've asked, what has shaped you and what has contributed to this? Mm-hmm. Realizing that probably this has not just come purely out of books, but also the way you've been socialized as a child, the kind of conversations you had around the dinner table, the kind of visitors who came through the house, all contribute in shaping, quite unconsciously, of course, some of the thoughts, ideas, and more importantly, the principles and the values that eventually, as an adult, will contribute to shaping your life.
I see. So that's set up Odan Secondary School?
Yes.
And I know that is a Presbyterian.
Yes.
Setting up Odan Secondary School, he must be strict. I'm just jumping straight to the conclusion. Putting the two together and saying, no, he will be strict.
Yes, I mean, Mom is a Methodist, but when she married, of course, you know, she then became a Presbyterian, though there isn't much of a difference. Mm. But I mean, the three songs in the Presbyterian church are quite fascinating, but I find the Methodist approach much more slightly liberal. But going back to that Presbyterian background, of course, that brought about a strictness that was unshakable, non-negotiable, and undisputable. And I think, I mean, that approach to life was very simple and straightforward. Okay, I'll sacrifice and pay your fees, I'll buy the books, and no shenanigans from you.
Case
closed. I mean, Mom was also a disciplinarian, but, you know, we could run to her and have a conversation, you know. But my grandparents, I think, have also been very influential. That's Mom, whose picture she still has on his living room wall, was absolutely a disciplinarian. I mean, she would tell you point blank, there are some homes that I don't expect you guys to mix with. I won't tolerate it that you marry from certain homes. And I remember when we were kids, we would go to the market, and then the market women would ask us, whose grandchild are you? and when we mentioned grandma's name, we would get a 5% to 10% discount. You know, I mean, she was a tough old lady.
This is Akimoda, or
no? I mean, that comes from Breman Brakwa.
Okay.
You know, where he started his political life. But post Akimoda, you know, Dr. Buzia made him the director for something called rural development.
Okay.
So that built low cost houses, clinics, schools all across this country.
Wow.
Dad is still alive, you know, actually at 85, married a rather charming young lady last Saturday.
Well, you congratulations. Know. Yeah,
thank
to
you
that.
Very much. I'll pass it on to him and I'll tell him to watch the program. You know, but the fascinating thing with that is that he built all these thousands of low cost houses. Two things. He never bought one. He never gave my mother one at Agunas Red Row. And he never allowed any single member of his family to purchase any of it. Because he didn't want a situation where people would say, look at that man, he's corrupt. So the little house that he managed to build for himself, that is what he lives in. You know, and it is that discipline that has run through his life and that he has then passed on to us. You know, so although he's a strong Presbyterian, all his boys went to Fansom School, all his daughters went to Mom's school, to Wesley Girls. You know, so not only is it discipline that is not founded on also academic discourse and, you know, knowledge. Mom is 86 and went to Wesley Girls probably about, 75 years ago. Okay, so I come from a tradition where it's now the fourth or the fifth generation of highly educated people. Dad also the same. So is discipline founded on an understanding of the underpinnings of what discipline, determination, integrity, and also your determination and ability to speak the truth can get you to? Dad's approach to life is that, you know what? This is not about a contest of beauty or friendship. If you don't do what is right, I'll walk you out. You know, so he's known for his no-nonsense, shooting from the hip. And I'll give you a very classic example of how Dad's behavior then supports and guides the kind of things that I do. Mm. About 5 years ago, I was in my office when my secretary came and told me, oh, there are three people from your father's village who have heard your name and they were just passing by, so came to say hello. So I told my secretary, look, ask them, I don't really remember. Do they have an appointment? And she said, no. I've looked into it. They don't have an appointment. So I told them that, look, it's rather unfortunate. I discipline my staff to do things in an orderly manner, so I'd be quite happy if they just called me and booked an appointment. So they went home over the weekend and complained to my father. Then my father said, my son has disappointed
me. He went to Kwesi's office and he won't see us.
Yeah. Then my father said, so what did he say? He said, oh, we should come back later. They said, oh, he has disappointed me. He ought to have got you arrested for going there without an appointment. So if you think you are coming to me so that the same discipline that his colleagues, he implements, he himself will flout it, then you are not going to get any traction with me. You know, so I think when you come from a family where every meeting is a conversation around values and principles and shared norms, okay, where you realize that because you come from a long history and tradition of elitist education in which you've got good people who are from your royalty, also from, you know, the ministry, they have a responsibility to use those skill sets for the public good. So in my family, where we focused on is on education. So dad was a teacher, mom was, my elder brother Andrew, just, you know, retired a teacher, myself, my brother Joe, who is at Winnebah, Sam, who teaches at Methodist University. And then my two younger sisters then decided to do something totally different. They went into diplomacy. You know, so Gifty and Dorcas are diplomats. But I think it's fascinating, you know, that all of us have decided to serve or use the privileged position and education that we've had, you know, for the public good. And I think you can do public service without being corrupt. And I think for my family and I, it's crucial that we put our knowledge at public disposal. Yet another aside, you know, when President Kufuor was in government, my younger brother Sam, there was a World Bank project, and Sam was responsible for a couple of ministries. But I remember the day he was appointed, my mother called an emergency family meeting and warned my brother Sam that you go out there, do your job, and the day you come back home, you hold your head high.
Really?
Okay, yeah. Mom would not tolerate.
But at this time, he's an adult. I'm assuming your brother would be an adult to be handed over this position, and yet still mom calls the meeting? Yeah.
No, mom always calls me when, you know, your colleagues in the media will call me sometimes. They don't know my name. They don't know where I work. They don't know my designation. They themselves are not even clear about what they want to talk about. So I get a little bit impatient with them. And if I'm with mom, we say, that kind of behavior and tone is not a proper one. You know, so I think for parents, we always remain kids. But more importantly, when she thinks, you know, that you are putting your reputation and your integrity and your name out there in a manner that people probably don't expect you to do. So there's always a balance between who you are, where you've come from, and certainly where you want to go.
Wow. So that principled Dr. Enin is from senior Enin.
Yes, definitely. Yes. But actually comes from, you know, both my grandparents. You know, those are the ones that I know or I met. But that principled disciplinarian approach to life and integrity and living within your means. No, dad was and is still unbribable. He will tell you, if because of your money you think I'll change my views, please. No, he will get up and open his door and tell you, leave. Okay. And I routinely do that too.
Doc, why security? Did you stumble on it, or growing up you thought, oh, you know what, I'm going to take interest in security?
Nana, my true passion as a child and even now is music. As a young kid, mom bought me a drum set. And I think for her it was, yes, you know, get this troublesome man out of my hair so that he would do something. But I got fascinated with playing those drums. And then by the time I was 10 and wanted to go to secondary school, then Apam Secondary School had the best, you know, band. My uncle Tony was teaching at Apam Secondary School then. So I came to that very boldly and rather naively that, look, Apam Secondary School has a good band, so I want to go to Apam. So I think you can guess his response and his reaction. Security came fairly tangentially.
Mm.
And I think when you asked me yesterday about what people don't know and what might have brought about the switch, I reflected and I think I can give that honor to probably the most fantastic teacher that I've ever had in history. You know, I'm originally trained as an historian.
No.
This was Dr. Kwaku Edu, the late Dr. Kwaku Edu at the University of Ghana, who taught us the history of the Fanti states in a manner that history came alive. You could imagine these pre-colonial states. And in doing that work, stumbled upon a relatively unknown queen mother of Cape Coast called Egwaba Brafo. Of course, Ya Santua is the more popular one, but I think modern historians will have to go back into the archives and look at Egwaba Brafo. Egwaba Brafo flouted all the rules and norms and protocols of society at that time, engaged the British on the beach, won a couple of battles. But as Queen Mother of Cape Coast, she was not actually supposed first to fight and secondly to go to the beach. But she thought she had to protect her people. Now that struck me very much as to why, you know, this woman flouted all regulations several hundred years ago. Then I went to Denmark as a refugee or as an asylum applicant, got asylum status, and wanted to do a PhD on 17th and 18th century Fanti diplomacy. I didn't find a supervisor who could supervise me, and therefore, you know, a chance meeting with one of the greatest political development theoreticians, Roger Lees. I was in the pub waiting for my train and quite, you know, upset that I had been told I couldn't get a supervisor, you know, for my doctoral program. So this old man comes into the pub and says, "Can I sit beside you?" And I fairly dismissively said, "Look, the pub doesn't belong to my father, so please feel free." So he sat down, ordered his beer, and very gently, over time, got us to talk. So I shared my frustrations with him, and he said, "Look, you're a refugee, you want to go to school, you've gotten an MPhil already. Look, if you can get the theory right, or if you can get the empirical side right, I, as a political scientist, will help you with the theory." So over several gallons of beer that night, we struck this deal. You know, so I came to security actually fairly tangentially, because I couldn't get somebody to supervise my doctoral dissertation in history. And I got, of course, Professor Roger Lees himself and Martin Kelstrop. You know, Martin Kelstrop was a world-renowned expert on security, and together with a man called Barry Buzan, you know, disaggregated security in its multiple, you know, components, economic, political, blah, 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 blah. So that is how I came to this. But I remember two interesting incidents during that doctoral process. One was that in Copenhagen, you had to do a couple of, you know, presentations. And at my first presentation, the only African or black man in this lily white society, my opponent then said, "Look, don't come and tell us funny stories about this institution called ECOWAS and that has actually sought to intervene in another African country. Look, we are here for serious business." And it just struck me, the level of ignorance in this highly enlightened country concerning our country. The second was that after I got my doctorate, there was a fancy party, and after everybody had gone to bed, my sister then comes and says, "Look, Kwesi, but this thing with people who shoot and kill each other that you've written on, who will employ you?" You will never get a job with this, your security stuff. You know, so we just laughed over it. And well, since 1998, when I got my doctorate, I've never had 2 minutes rest.
So if you had someone to, you know, supervise your original thesis, you'd have branched into history.
I would have been a historian, focusing on Fanti diplomacy in the 17th and 18th century. Yeah.
I'm just trying to figure out which would have served us better. But, you know, for now, we are getting the most of you. We're going to take a quick break. When I come back, the conversation continues. Don't go away. Well, thank you very much for staying, getting to know Dr. Kwesi Yedin, our darling security specialist. But Doc, let me be inquisitive. You're talking about, asylum, and why would you want to seek asylum in Denmark?
Well, I think one of the things that people forget in this country is that they know that we went through a revolutionary period. But the politics prior to and during the revolutionary period, most people seem to have forgotten. You know, so when I teach my graduate students, and I use words like kalabule, jinabu, what kind of Neanderthal is standing here teaching us?
But you remember, expect in 19... kalabule, you expect to know kalabule?
No, people don't know. The younger ones don't know.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, in 1982, December 1981, yeah, 31st December, which interestingly enough is the day that, you know, Denmark sold all its properties in this country to the British, goats, fowls, human beings, and castles and forts. The revolution came 31st December 1981. Of course, as young students at the university, we jammed and supported the revolution. You know, so if you go to my father's village at Bremen Brakwa right now, a bus stop that we built as young students supporting the revolution is still there. You know, the revolution galvanized the dynamism and enthusiasm of Ghanaians and gave people real vision and hope of where we wanted to go. But the murder of the judges changed everything. Okay. And from the murder of the judges, we began to see student activists saying, no, this is not what we wanted. But around that time, two new institutions had been established. That is the committees for the defense of the revolution at community level to say, let's galvanize communities, and workers' defense committees at workplaces. At the University of Ghana, as student activists decided to say no to the revolution, the workers' defense committees and then committees for the defense of the revolution became more and more violent and aggressive. Of course, the military was under revolutionary control. You know, so we were brutalized first in November 1982, in June 1983, and the most violent and the most brutal one around November 1983 again, and the final straw that broke the camel's back around 1985. Now, at a point in time, it had become so violent that you didn't know what could happen and when the next knock on your door would come. I then decided, after all my escapades and the troubles I had got, that enough was enough. So traveled from here to Nigeria, where I got all my money stolen. There was an airline called Interflug that was owned by the East German state. So flew from here to East Berlin on my younger brother's passport. And after a lot of difficulties, managed to enter East Berlin. Absolutely no money. Met a couple of Angolan and Mozambican students who entertained me because of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's name and because I was Ghanaian. Sold the few things that I had, and then with another Ghanaian, went to the Interflug office once more and said, look, this is all the money we have gathered. They were in US dollars. Can you get us a ticket somewhere? Please, we don't want to go to West Berlin or anywhere in Germany, because they were close to about 100,000 Ghanaian refugees or asylum applicants. So this woman quickly pocketed our dollars and gave us a one-way ticket. Those days, of course, Osama bin Laden and his friends had not, you know, shocked all of us. Mm-hmm. So with one waiting, we didn't even actually look at it. You know, boarded a flight, realized when we were landing that this was pristine sea, beautiful boats, people having fun, landed only to realize we were in Copenhagen. But of course, I sought asylum immediately at the airport because I identified myself. I didn't have the proper papers, you know, so driven at top speed to a place called the Sandholm camp, re-interviewed and brought into prison called Vester Fengsel in Copenhagen in isolation for a couple of weeks. And I think after 3 weeks, I was released, sent to a proper refugee camp. Now, let me tell you a very interesting story. In prison, it was so comfortable that I could have stayed there for quite some time. The food was good, the linen was clean. If I watched the film, I was paid. If I took a walk, I was paid. If I read a book, I was paid. Everything was paid. Now, by the time I left, you know, it was cold, so I was given a jacket. But the jacket had an embroidery here called KF. And I walked in town very boldly, mm-hmm. until somebody said, do you know what KF means? I said, no. It says, KF means Kubenhavn's Fengsel. It means Copenhagen's prisons. So I was walking quite proudly in town.
With your embossed jacket.
Oh, with my embossed jacket. And people thought, but that's an ex-convict. You know. But another fascinating thing with the prison life in Copenhagen was that I met this Gambian who was really sweet and said, look, young man, go back to school. Okay, don't be fascinated by the pleasures of the flesh in this country. Go back to school. But he was so concerned for my welfare that he gave me telephone numbers and said, look, when you are desperate, call these numbers and whatever you want, they will do it for you. I called the numbers just to check. They were good numbers. But I didn't know his background and trust him, so I basically just, you know, ripped them apart. 6 months after entering Denmark, I was given United Nations Article 7 Convention refugee status. Denmark was truly fantastic. The integration process was great. Learned Danish to the level of A-level within 8 months. Taught by a great teacher called Esther Larsen. Entered Copenhagen University, did an MPhil, became an advisor to the Interior Minister on migrant issues, established a band, you know, an unplugged band called Samerima, you know, traveled around the whole of Denmark.
Really?
Playing traditional Ghanaian music.
So what did you do, drumming or singing?
I did the conga and the photo from, yeah. Well, talking about drumming and singing, I actually did dance at the University of Ghana. Okay. And my dance exam was the Dambai Takai. So got asylum, settled down, went back to school, did all sorts of interesting things. But throughout my time in Denmark, spoke about Ghana and the political developments here and fought the Danish government tooth and nail not to bring aid to the Rawlings regime because my argument was that it extended that regime. When democracy was re-established, established the MPP, a branch of the MPP with a few people, tried to get some materials and equipment to the party because for me, it was following on from my mother's side and my father's side. Although I'm not interested in active politics, I thought whatever you could do to support and help the party was necessary. And then around 1998 or 99, went to South Africa to work and realized that now the salary I got in South Africa was so astronomical, I was shocked. I arrived in South Africa on a Thursday, went to work on a Monday and resigned on Wednesday. I realized that every single Caucasian, including the typist, earned more money than I did. And I said, coming from Nkrumah's Ghana, I will not tolerate it. But I had expressed an interest in coming home. So the Danish Foreign Ministry, I think, spoke to Dr. Charles Mensah. So I was repatriated back to Ghana and worked first when I came with the IEA.
Even though the money was good?
It's a matter of principle. You know, so for me, issues of principle and integrity are key. So that, let's say you are located in this center, which is a Ministry of Defense center. Okay, most people will say, look, I work under a center that is an ancillary to the MOD. You shouldn't speak out. But for me, I think it's crucial as a matter of principle that when I stay here and train people who are coming from countries that the freedom of speech is curtailed, individual freedoms and rights have been destroyed, that when I see such developments in my country, I'm able to speak about it and I'm able to write about it. Yeah, so the money is not the same. I mean, I've worn this kaftan probably for 10 years. At my age, look, I don't.
Yeah. Wow. So at which year did you return to Ghana?
Atta Mills invited me for a conference in 1998, I think.
Okay.
And I returned finally just before the 2000 elections, I think in August 2000. Yeah.
By then, you were satisfied with the system?
I think the change had begun. I mean, it had gathered enough momentum, you know, that I was convinced that there couldn't be a reversal. And I think, to be fair to Mr. Rawlings, there was a certain openness, accountability, and also transparency about the process. Yes, granted that in 1992, the MPP had written the stolen, you know, verdict. But subsequent to that, all the elections had improved and improved and improved. So by August 2000, when Dr. Charles Mensah invited me to come home, I thought, yes, I could come and then help with the process. So for that election, the EU funded us to do what we called then constituency parliamentary debates at the constituency, you know, level, trying to bring this presidential debates down to the constituency level, where we would line up all the candidates, 5 minutes each, local language, people ask you questions. You know, so it was a very fascinating thing. Look, people are driven by a thirst for power and money. Power is only good, or leadership positions are only good, if you can use it for the common good and transform lives and create opportunities for other less, you know, lucky people. Nana, money is good if you can use it to do good things. But if you have money and it's only to fill your tummy, that is not the proper way to go. So for me, it's about ensuring that you contribute to where you live, where you stay, and also creating opportunities for younger people and mentoring them to see beyond their own pecuniary individual interest. For me, I think the collective good is very important to me.
So how fulfilling is it for you knowing that, you know, we all, majority of us, depend on you for security advice, security guidance, security commentary? Every serious institution, being foreign embassies here, local stations, I'm sure your friends, personally. How fulfilling is it for you, knowing that you could have been a historian or a bandsman?
No, I think I think the fulfillment comes later. It is the sense of responsibility that one word out of place can cause serious trouble. So it is a heavy burden of responsibility. You know, normally when I don't trust people, I don't do recorded interviews. Because people can fidget with it and change the sequencing of the words and they can mean, you know, something else. Two, I normally don't like people calling me and saying, oh, we want to take you on air in 20 minutes or 30 minutes. Because I always tell people that what I do is to teach and to explain and to reduce tensions. Now, although that is my perception, you see, peace is not a common good. So in trying to explain and to discuss and to ensure that you bring enlightenment to a particular issue, people play games with your words so that they will paint you in a particular color. You know, the good thing about it is that in the last 19 years, when people are in opposition, they say, you support this government or you support that. So I'm at peace with myself. But I think for me, it's more a sense of responsibility. And also knowing that if you enjoy that credibility and that respect, whatever you say, you know, carries some weight. And you can either worsen a situation or bring it under control. My interest consistently is to bring it under control, but I will still shoot from the hip. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I'll say it as
it's very much expected. Talking about the institution, yeah. Fianan Center yep. for Peace Keeping, mm-hmm. Well, now it's grown, and I'm sure you know you have people coming from outside of Ghana and everything. I mean, what's their perception of this institution? What has this perception been? I mean, you being inside, what are the reports you are getting?
Well, nobody knows us in Ghana. You know, people pass in front of us and they see the flags flying, the nice blue buildings. And because we have a lot of high-profile visitors, you know, people see soldiers standing outside and they think it's a purely military institution. This is a hybrid institution, military, police, and civilians, you know, working as much as possible from our very different professional backgrounds, you know, to build this institution. Nana, I can tell you that people think that success is sweet. Success brings such a burden, and particularly the burden of the name of the man that we bear. So internationally, we've become the world's leading peacekeeping training school. When the BBC or the VOA or Australian telly calls and we give even an interpretational comment, they take it as the gospel truth. Okay, so that puts a heavy burden on anyone who speaks for and on behalf of the center. Mm. Internationally, we've also reached a stage where there's something called the go-to, you know, think tanks that tries to rank about the 9,000 most important, you know, think tanks all over the world. In the last 5 to 6 years, we've always been rated in a particular category on international peace and security and then international relations. This year, we were the highest-ranked African institution. Now, the crucial thing about this is that we are running in the same category with institutions like the Brookings, probably with a $2 billion annual budget, the Carnegie Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the RUSI, IISS, world-class heavyweight institutions. You know, so for us to sit here with our tiny budget of probably $100,000 a year and be able to deliver to that level, I think for me, I'm very proud of my colleagues, and mm-hmm. particularly because they're also very young and very sharp. So what it means is that long-term, we'll be able to maintain the standards and hopefully do it much better. So the international reputation and expectations from us, both from the UN, the African Union, and ECOWAS, is that when there's a request for training, we say yes, which we consistently do. You know, so we are putting up a new academic and training block because mm-hmm. our classrooms are full. But what makes us different is that we just don't teach, that teaching is underpinned by hands-on empirical research of our lived experience. So let's say, for example, we are teaching on human rights or responsibility to protect. we try to bring the research to support that. So over time, yes, we've built this reputation, but it's a constant struggle getting the funding to keep on doing the work. It's a constant struggle making sure that you maintain the standard that you've set for yourself. Mm-hmm. And you know yourself that as a leader, it's a constant struggle trying to keep people in line. But like I said, that is the least of my problems.
Well done. Take a quick break and we're coming back. Don't move. Well, thank you very much for staying. And Doug, what next after the Kofi Annan Center for Peacekeeping?
What next? Yes. I want to hopefully buy a small boat, learn how to sail, do my gardening. I love to cook.
Your band history?
When I was 15, my kids gave me a tenor saxophone.
Okay.
Which I haven't learned how to play yet. So I think I'll spend some time learning how to play the sax. But I think it will be actually learning how to sail for pleasure.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
Sea sailing or lake river sailing?
Sea sailing.
Oh, you're brave.
I think taking a couple of risks.
Even popping to Ivory Coast on your boat.
Oh, no, just maybe do a kilometer, lay some anchor, and then catch cassava fish, catch sole. I think if I'm lucky, I get some shrimp and then some lobster. Yeah.
That would be interesting. But you see, I think the path that you have chosen, you may retire, but we can't let you retire unless you change your numbers. We'll probably even write to you.
No, I only have one number. this penchant for holding X number of phones and Y number of numbers. No, I just have one. No, I think I will still be engaged. I think it's crucial. When I retire to my country home, I think I'll still do some mentoring. I think that's important. Probably try and write another book or two. But I think when I retire, I think 75% of my time will purely be for pleasure. Yeah.
Doc, why is it that as Ghanaians, I don't know if I can say Africans, but let me focus on Ghanaians, that security is never on top of the list? It's like an afterthought.
Yeah.
Is it cultural or just habit?
Well, I think it's a deliberate manipulative process to make security seem, to quote Mr. Kwanson, very humudious. That, look, this is a no-go area. That then allows those professional securocrats and their political masters, to present this as a no-go area. So if you look at when the Fourth Republic, for example, we can go much further back. Political party manifestos have seen security as tangential to development, instead of seeing security as the fulcrum around which development should revolve. That's one. Number two is that security management is still fairly limited to the professional securocrats, whilst the political class is playing catch up. But with the expansion of civil society and civil society groups beginning to focus on and specialize in security, I think in the Ghana case, we are beginning to see a slight change. The third also is that in Ghana, quite a number of our political class have emanated from civil society. So the nexus between politicians, politics, and civil society is getting closer and closer and closer, although some individuals would want to put people at a distance. But because the knowledge resides within civil society, we are beginning to see, if you take the Ayawaso case and the voices that civil society comes up with, those are voices that cannot be overlooked. People are interpreting this in the context of Act 526, which is the Security and Intelligence Services Act. They are interpreting what has happened in the context of the Constitution, in terms of party manifestos. So suddenly we've brought security squarely into the center of our business. And I think that is how it should be. Mm-hmm. Without security, there can be development, there can be stability. We will live in societies of fear. You know, so I think in the short term, the Ayawasu case has been very disturbing. But I think going forward, that will be the turning point in this country's history where security became a common household name and everybody who has an idea will bring it onto the table.
Difficult one. Well, let me throw it at you.
Yes.
We don't have the never again spirit. So we live through mistakes over and over and over. Do you think Ayawasu would shock us enough not to live through this mistake, or we'll sit down and the next election go through the same thing again?
I don't think we've reached the never again stage. The commission and the recommendations that they come with and the subsequent white paper and implementation of that subsequent white paper will contribute to helping us either to prevent a never again situation or actually worsen it. And that's why it's crucial, you know, that this commission's work is done as thoroughly as possible. But already in the last couple of sittings, you can see that the questions are tough, they are incisive, and we've seen, you know, the controversies and the contradictions that are beginning to pop up. And I mean, this morning my radio was just scanning. And on almost every station, there were erudite analysts who are saying, look, but the commission ought to have asked these questions. The commission ought to have followed up on this thread. So I hope that the research support for the commission is good enough, and then they can recall some of the people who have appeared before them and ask, you know, supplementary questions.
That should be very good. Doc, you know what I forgot to ask? Your original thesis was going to be about the Fanti history.
Yeah.
So what did you change it to?
My doctoral dissertation in political science was about the ECOWAS intervention in Liberia.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was on diplomacy. Fanti diplomacy in the 17th and 18th century.
And then we change it to the ECOWAS intervention.
20th century.
So that was when security was born. That's when the security, you know, path was charted.
Well, it was the beginning both for a deeper understanding or the need for a deeper understanding about security. Mm-hmm. But for me, that was when the ECOWAS project took off, truly. Because people were wondering, why should 8 ECOWAS countries intervene in another country? Liberia, that had never paid its assessed contributions to ECOWAS, saw these troops come in, people losing their lives, and West African countries taking in hundreds of thousands of Liberians. And suddenly, for us as ordinary West Africans, that ECOMOC intervention said, we are one, and we can get it done. 2 developments. The Secretary General, Perez de Cuellar, said the UN agenda was too full, so they couldn't consider ECOWAS, this intervention. So we did it without UN recognition, and we have absolutely no regrets for it. The second was that in 1994, the Maastricht Treaty was signed, and suddenly the CFA zone were cut off to be on their own. So the Francophonies realized that they can go to Paris as much as possible, they can speak French more mellifluously than the French, but the only people they can depend on are their West African brothers. So those 2 developments have contributed to bringing this sense of eco-optimism in West Africa.
Security, ECOWAS, after ECOMOG, have we stepped it up any bit, or we went back to sleep after ECOMOG?
We slept, and in sleeping, we're overtaken by new developments. Mm. Liberia and Sierra Leone opened released new and dangerous developments of small arms flows, of collusion between official government agents and criminal gangs, the entry of radicalized religious leaders, and then the expansion of violent extremism. Post-Liberia and Sierra Leone, one would have thought that there would have been a reflective set of moments to say what really happened in Liberia and Sierra Leone. What are the forces that have been generated and released that can come back to bite us? That was not done. And that is why we see the insecurities in West Africa increasingly coming down south from Burkina Faso and encircling us in this country.
Doc, this has been wonderful. It's been absolutely insightful. But in 1 minute, from, let me say, 35 and below,
yeah,
what should they do with regards to security awareness? For 35 and above, we cannot be saved. So 35 and below, you know, in 1 minute, what can they do for create security awareness better for themselves than we do?
A consciousness that we cannot do without security, a sharpened sense of looking around us and remembering even things that pass in a flash. And I'm saying this because we still can't get an identikit for Mr. Swale's murderers. Everywhere else, security is not only driven by the state, but by the 6 or 7 people in this room. Like we can all describe in terms of color, height, weight, age. So we need to bring security as a lived experience, as an everyday engagement, so that we can recollect, we can talk about it, we can describe, and we can provide information.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So now you know Dr. Kosiedi. Now you know Dr. Kosiedi, and I'm so glad that I got to know him. So it's not that he slept, woke up and said he was a security expert. No, he went through the mill. And that's one thing that I always want to leave with my young audience, that look, you need to go through the mill. Well, the number is 024-366-2001, and that's Tantees. They give me my shirts for the show, so give them a call. Get yourself a nice shirt. But until I come to you next Friday with a different personality, you know what? Have a good week. And, Doc, thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Nana. Thank you.